Today we're going to look at five parameters of hypergraphs. Independence number, strong independence number, transversal number, matching number, and cover number. To begin, let's review what an independent set is in a hypergraph. In graph theory, an independent set is a set of mutually non-adjacent vertices. In hypergraph theory, an independent set is a set of vertices that do not contain any edge as a subset. It's straightforward to verify that for the case where all edges contain two vertices, these definitions are equivalent. However, when we allow for edges of size 3 or greater, as in hypergraphs, we allow for the possibility that two vertices in an independent set are adjacent to each other, which is an interesting difference between independent sets in graph and in hypergraph theory. As an example, AC in the hypergraph shown here is an independent set, even though A and C are adjacent. ABC would not be an independent set, because edge E sub 2 would be entirely contained within our set. As another example, in this hypergraph, the set ABC is an independent set, even though B and C are adjacent. Again, the fact that ABC is an independent set just means that there's no subset of ABC that's an edge in our hypergraph. Now, if we were to include vertex D in this set, we would no longer have an independent set, because BCD is an edge in our graph, and it's also a subset of ABCD. Notice that if we have an independent set S, we can add an isolated vertex V and obtain another independent set. Also, vertices incident to a singleton edge or loop, such as vertex F in this hypergraph, cannot be included in any independent set. The size of the largest independent set in a hypergraph H is known as the independence number of H, denoted by alpha of H. For hypergraphs with at least one vertex not contained in a singleton edge, the independence number of the hypergraph is at least 1, and it's at most equal to the number of vertices in the hypergraph. This is because if these criteria are satisfied, there's at least one vertex that we could include that doesn't make up an edge, and we can't include more vertices than there are in the hypergraph. Here's an example of a hypergraph with independence number 0. Every vertex is incident to some singleton edge. Now let's look at another type of set, strongly independent sets. A strongly independent set is a set of vertices that are mutually non-adjacent. This is in complete agreement with the definition of independent set in graph theory. If you're used to dealing with independent sets in graph theory, then this is what you can think of as the most direct generalization of independent sets in graph theory to hypergraph theory. For example, in this hypergraph, the set ABC is a strongly independent set because none of the vertices in ABC are adjacent to any other vertices in ABC. However, if we add vertex D and remove vertex B, we no longer have a strongly independent set, as C and D are adjacent, but we would have an independent set, because no edge is completely contained within our set. This demonstrates that some independent sets are not strongly independent sets. Also, while ABC is a strongly independent set, it's not an independent set, because ABC contains an edge as a subset, the loop E sub 2. That demonstrates that some strongly independent sets are not independent sets. Basically, independent sets cannot include vertices incident to a singleton edge, while strongly independent sets can. And strongly independent sets cannot include vertices incident to the same edge, while independent sets can. The size of the largest strongly independent set in a hypergraph H is called the strong independence number, and we denote it by alpha bar of H. Let's move on to transversals. A set T of vertices in a hypergraph is said to be a transversal if for every edge in our hypergraph, there's a vertex in T that's incident to that edge. Another way to think about it is that T contains at least one vertex from each edge in the hypergraph. Intuitively, if we're playing a game of selecting vertices in a hypergraph, where selecting a vertex highlights all the edges containing it, then selecting a transversal would highlight all the edges in the hypergraph. For example, in this hypergraph, the set ABE is a transversal because edge E sub 1 contains at least one vertex in our set. In this case, it contains both vertices A and B. Edge E sub 2 contains at least one vertex in our set. In this case, vertices B and E. And edge E sub 3 contains at least one vertex in our set, vertex E. Notice that if there's any vertex present in all edges, the set containing that vertex alone would be a transversal. In this hypergraph, the set of vertices containing only C is a transversal. Also, if all edges are singletons, then to form a transversal, we need at least as many vertices as there are edges. And more generally, we always need at least as many vertices in a transversal as there are vertices contained by singleton edges. If there's any empty edge in a hypergraph, there's no transversal in that hypergraph. But as long as there are no empty edges, there is a transversal. The easiest one to find is the set of all vertices in the hypergraph. Since the set of all vertices is obviously the largest transversal, we can ask ourselves, what's the size of the smallest transversal? That number is known as the transversal number, tau of h. There's often not a unique minimum transversal. For example, our current hypergraph has several minimum transversals, all requiring at least two vertices, so our transversal number is 2. It's important to know that if a set T is a transversal, then the complement of T, that is all the vertices in the hypergraph that are not in T, is an independent set. This comes from the fact that every edge has at least one vertex in T, so the set of vertices not in T cannot include an entire edge as a subset. As an example, BF is a transversal, while its complement is an independent set. Additionally, for hypergraphs without empty edges, if a set S is an independent set, then its complement is a transversal. This is because no edge has all its vertices in S, by definition of independent set. So every edge has to have at least one vertex not in S. That is, every edge has at least one vertex in the complement of S, meaning the complement of S is a transversal. This brings us to our first relationship between different hypergraph parameters. For hypergraphs without empty edges, the sum of the independence number with a transversal number equals the number of vertices in the hypergraph. This is a consequence of our earlier two facts. Moving on, a set of edges, M, in a hypergraph is said to be a matching if the edges in M are disjoint. Another way to write this is that a matching is a set of edges that are mutually not adjacent. As an example, in this hypergraph, E sub 1, E sub 4 is a matching, and it has size 2 because that's the number of edges it contains. It's not a maximal matching, as we could add E sub 3 and obtain a larger matching of size 3. This new matching also happens to be a perfect matching, which is when every vertex in the hypergraph is incident to some edge of our matching. The size of the largest matching in a hypergraph H is known as its matching number, nu of H. In this hypergraph, the largest matching has 3 edges, so the matching number is 3. Notice that a matching in a hypergraph H must be a strongly independent set in the dual of H. As the edges of H become the vertices of the dual, meaning any set of mutually non-adjacent edges in H become a set of mutually non-adjacent vertices in the dual of H. Similarly, any strongly independent set in the dual of a hypergraph is a matching in the original hypergraph. Combining these facts, we arrive at our second relationship between hypergraph parameters. The matching number of H equals the strong independence number of the dual of H. Before we move on to our last parameter, the cover number, let's look at a relationship between transversals and matchings. First, all the edges in a matching are disjoint, so no vertex in the hypergraph can be incident to more than one edge in our matching. Now, if we have a transversal T and a matching M, every vertex in T can be incident to at most one edge from M. This implies that we need at least as many vertices in T as we have edges in M. As an example, if we had a matching with 5 edges, then in a transversal we would need at least 5 vertices, one to be incident to each edge in our matching. We might need more than 5 in order to be incident to all the other edges in our hypergraph, but we definitely need at least 5. If we have a maximum matching, any transversal must have at least as many vertices as there are edges in that maximum matching. Meaning the size of the smallest transversal must be greater than or equal to the size of the largest matching. This means that whenever we have a transversal with exactly as many vertices as our maximum matching, it has to be a minimum transversal. The transversal number must equal the matching number in this case. Also, if we ever have a matching with as many edges as there are vertices in our minimum transversal, that matching must be maximum, again meaning that the transversal number and matching number are equal. This brings us to the Kernig property, which is the property that the transversal number and matching number are equal. Our previous hypergraph satisfies this property, as we know that our matching number is 3, and we can choose just 3 vertices such that our selection is a transversal. ADG is one possibility. Let's move on to the last parameter in this video, the cover number. A set of edges C in a hypergraph is a covering if for every vertex in our hypergraph, there's an edge in C that is incident to that vertex. Two other ways to think about it are that a covering is a set of edges that exhausts the vertices in the hypergraph, or that a covering is a set of edges whose union is the vertex set of the hypergraph. Note that if a hypergraph has an isolated vertex, it has no coverings. As an example, in this hypergraph, the set E1, E2, E4 is a covering, as every vertex in the hypergraph is incident to at least one edge in our set. However, E1, E3 would not be a covering, because the union of E1 with E3 is missing vertex D. Now, the smallest covering in this example requires 2 edges. It's E2, E4. We call the size of the smallest covering in a hypergraph H the cover number of H, denoted by rho of H. The cover number of this example is 2. To finish the video, let's look at 2 relationships between the cover number and the other parameters that we've looked at. First, for hypergraphs where coverings exist, the cover number of a hypergraph equals the transversal number of its dual. This is because a covering C in the original hypergraph is a set of edges such that for every vertex in our hypergraph, there's an edge in C that's incident to that vertex. Intuitively, the dual operation preserves incidence between objects of different types. So in the dual hypergraph, our covering C becomes a set C prime of vertices, such that for every edge in the dual hypergraph, there's a vertex in C prime that's incident to that edge. Similarly, it's also true that a transversal in the original hypergraph becomes a covering in the dual hypergraph. As a result, the size of the smallest covering in the original must equal the size of the smallest transversal in the dual. Again, hypergraphs that have an isolated vertex do not have a covering number, nor do their duals have a transversal number. For our second relationship involving the cover number, let's consider hypergraphs whose duals satisfy the Kernig property. Also, let's recall two properties from earlier, which are that the matching number of a hypergraph equals the strong independence number of its dual, and that the transversal number of a hypergraph equals the cover number of its dual. Together, these facts tell us that the dual of the hypergraph satisfies the Kernig property if and only if the original hypergraph's covering number equals the original hypergraph's strong independence number. We call this the dual Kernig property. All it really means is that the dual satisfies the Kernig property. Here's an example of a hypergraph that satisfies this property. Note how the dual satisfies the Kernig property. As a quick summary, we looked at five hypergraph parameters, each relating to a special type of set of vertices or set of edges in a hypergraph: independence number, strong independence number, transversal number, matching number, and cover number. We looked at several relationships between these parameters, such as the fact that the independence number plus the transversal number equals the number of vertices for hypergraphs without an empty edge, the matching number equals the strong independence number of the dual, the cover number equals the transversal number of the dual for hypergraphs without an isolated vertex, and the Kernig and dual Kernig properties. That's it for this video. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe. Have a great day.